So that fish hit this zoo cougar, destroyed it. Look at that. Destroyed that zoo cougar. It's all backwards now and everything. And what happened was when it hit, it wrapped around my line, it broke off, and we were devastated. And then all of a sudden, we turned around and he was literally sitting in the water right behind us. And so I crept up on him. I saw him just sitting in the weeds, and I crept up behind him and I slowly slid my net right in front of his face. And then I tapped his tail and he shot right into my net. Game over.
Hey, what's up, guys? Thanks for checking out Dark Waters Fly Shop YouTube channel. My name's Seth. I'm gonna take you through part two of Midwest mousing. In the last episode, it was basically just trying to get you guys jacked on mousing. Out at night, middle of nowhere, small streams, big fish, total sensory deprivation, a whole bunch of really bad things all combined into one thing. Super, super hard. Amazing return if it happens. In this video, what I'm gonna do is give you a whole bunch more tips on how to become successful at mousing at night in our Midwest trout streams. Before I get into those tips, I wanna reiterate two things before I start. The first thing, I had somebody comment on the last video that said, I see you're using zoo cougars. Those aren't mouse patterns. You're not really mousing. Just so that you guys know, I'm using that term mousing somewhat loosely. I'm throwing topwater patterns on a river at night. They could be mouse, they could be fish coming up to the surface, they could be frogs, who knows what they are. I'm just saying that like a lot of times these fish are striking at these things and we're using a lot of patterns that look like mice. So it's a topwater pattern. We could call it topwatering if you'd rather, but we call it mousing. The second thing that I want to reiterate in this video is that my information that I'm giving you is based specifically on Midwest streams. I don't want you guys to think that I'm talking about fishing out east or down south or up in Alaska or in Montana or anywhere else. I'm talking about the Midwest and the information that I'm giving you. I don't want to give you guys the impression that I'm speaking beyond my scope of experience because I don't really want to do that. All right, number one, most commonly asked question, what kind of lights can you or can't you use when you're mousing at night? You know, obviously you can't get to the river without using some kind of a headlamp or a flashlight or something like that. What happens when you need to re-rig? Obviously I can't tie knots without seeing, so what do? Headlamps, use them, that's fine. Keep them off when you're fishing, and when you're approaching the water that you're gonna be targeting, don't have them on. That's gonna present some challenges because you're not gonna know where to cast. That's where practice comes in. This video is gonna help you out, but it cannot substitute time on the water for you guys at night. As far as the difference between like white light and red light, some guys think that it's safe to mouse at night using a red light and just leaving the lamp on. What you guys gotta realize is that the fish can see out of the water, especially at night if there's light. What that does is it's throwing all these shadows on the trees and they're moving, and that's gonna put the fish down. The key is that if you're gonna turn your light on to tie a knot, we're fishing upstream mostly, so if you want to face downstream and do that, that's cool. Typically what I do is I just go up onto shore, I kind of stick my head in the bushes, and then I'll turn my lamp on and work in a way that the rest of the light is not shining all over the rest of the water that I'm hoping to fish. All right, the next thing I want to talk to you guys about is the difference between brown trout and brook trout, their feeding patterns at night, and how that also corresponds to the moon phase and the differences that take place there. Let's start with brown trout. There's a lot of science that says that brown trout in the Midwest here become almost 100% nocturnal at night. That's why we wanna get out at night and practice these mousing techniques to catch these fish. The other thing that's really interesting is I've got some friends that are fisheries biologists that have told me they've tagged brown trout at night and tracked them, and some of these brown trout will travel up to 9 miles in one evening on a feeding binge. And you'll be surprised in some of the places you'll find them because they're not afraid of predators at night. A lot of times you'll find these giant fish in like 6 inches of water waiting for a frog or a mouse or something to jump in the water and go at it. The moment when that changes for brown trout, I've found, is in the case of a full moon, it's bad news. I've gone out at night in a full moon and thought, oh, maybe they'll hit, you know, and I've got absolutely nothing. Even to the point where cloud cover would come in and cover that moon, and within 5 minutes, now all of a sudden these brown trout are becoming extremely active. As soon as that cloud cover went away, they shut right off. I'm not sure if this is 100% true or not, but I've had guys tell me that brown trout, the way their eyes work is very similar to walleyes, where there's like a mirror somewhere in there and it like doubles the amount of light coming to their pupil or something like that. But I know that they're extremely light sensitive. The brook trout are extremely different. There's been a number of nights where I go out on a full moon and the brown trout are non-active at all. I'll actually move streams. I'll go to a river that I know has large brook trout in it, and those brook trout will be feeding like crazy all night long. What's interesting is the takes seem to be different. The brook trout takes are a lot more subtle, which is surprising to me. At night, the brown trout will hammer those flies. At night, when I fly fish with mouse patterns for brook trout, the takes are like extremely subtle. Sometimes it's even hard to know when you have a fish hit until your line tightens up. Another thing I want to talk about is water speed. When you're picking the water that you're going to mouse at night for these trout on, it's extremely important that if you're going to use the techniques that we use here, which is an upstream technique, you've got to find water that has a little bit of a slower current. The reason why is when we cast upstream, we're gonna be using a reach cast. When that mouse pattern hits the water, it's extremely important that you get it a good, you give it a good pop right off the bat, boom, so that they can hear where that fly is. And what's gonna happen is they're gonna be able to target that. But if the current is too fast, it's gonna come back toward you so fast that you can't get that line stripped in appropriately. So it's really important that you find a river that's water current is slow enough where you can get that fly to pop appropriately. All right, so the last thing I'm gonna discuss here, which I think is extremely important, is one of the rigging techniques that we're gonna use. In the next video, I'm gonna go over like, you know, the weight rods that we use, the length of rods, type of line, and how we rig specifically. But one key element that I think is extremely important is you guys need to know that when you're going out fishing at night, you're limited to the amount of light that you can use. You need to be as prepared as possible. And one of the things that I do is I use something called an InvisiSwivel. It's made by Aquatico. You can get these in different pound test ratings. At night, the fish are not line shy because their vision is also a little bit more limited during the evening. So you can get away with a heavier tippet, which gives you connection to that fish right away. You can set the hook harder. You can pull that fish harder. You can get it right in your net right away before it runs up onto the tag others or underneath logs. The reason why this InvisiSwivel is so handy is one, it's fluorocarbon, so it's not weighted. It's not gonna pull your fly down in the water column. But the main reason why I use them is because when you're casting these large flies at night, here's one that's an example. Giant head zoo cougar here that's gonna float. Talk about why I like to use these flies with large heads in the next episode. But when you cast this thing, it's gonna twist on you in the air. The more you're casting and you can't see your line, what will typically happen is you don't know you have a tangle until you hear it going through the air. You know, it's sounding different when you're casting it. You bring it back and you've got a bird nest. And the reason why that's happening is because your fly is twisting the entire time that it's in the air. If you put one of these InvisiSwivels in line, those twists are only gonna go back as far as you put that InvisiSwivel, where we tie that thing about 18 inches back from our fly. And it's gonna untwist, and so you're not gonna have any line twists whatsoever. All right, a little extra credit tip here for you. One thing that you guys also want to keep in mind is the more false casts that you're doing at night when you can't see ups the odds that you're going to wind up snagged on something that you don't want to be snagged on. And so one thing that I do that's extremely helpful at night when I'm wading in these smaller streams is I'll practice what's called a water load cast. And what a water load cast is when you strip your line out, you almost sometimes you can cast your line behind you or whatever, but if you've got a lot of overhanging brush or trees or tag elders, you let that thing go back downstream behind you. And what you'll do is you'll do a haul cast where you're pulling that line in. The friction on the water will load your rod and you can throw that thing forward and you can throw a 25-foot cast if you need to and keep that thing a foot to 2 feet above the water underneath all of those trees. That line will land straight, you pop it, and then just retrieve that line as it's coming in toward you and then listen for the take. But that water load cast is extremely important. There's various stretches of river that I'll fish where I can't false cast at all, and all I can do is I can feed that line downstream and then I can get a good cast upstream with a water load and keep that thing very close to the top of the water so I'm not winding up snagging all kinds of branches. All right, guys, thanks for checking out this video. Make sure you subscribe so that you'll be notified when the next video pops up. In the next video, I'm going to go over rod weights with you, more casting techniques, the different flies that we use, how we rig our leaders, and I'm going to try to, again, stack all the cards in your favor so that when you get out mousing at night, you're as successful as possible and you can, you know, just beat all of the learning curves that held me back for the first couple of years of doing this. Thanks for watching this video. Share it with your friends. Have a good day. Peace.